Blackstone Publishing presents The Survival of Margaret Thomas by Del Howison. This book is read by Carol Monda. For my mother and Jay Patton, two people responsible for getting me started. Also for George Willis, who kept me going when times and circumstances would have ended it all. The three of you have been there without request. You will never know how much it means to me. For my father, who passed on his love of westerns to me. Also, I dedicate this to my wife, Sue. Now you know what has been bouncing about in my head for the past several years. The writer, now that his work is concluded, is not inclined to dwell on the difficulties under which he labored in the preparation of the present volume. The facts and anecdotes brought together in the following pages were found to be very widely scattered and frequently accompanied by details which, on no possible pretense, could now be openly published. No apology is offered for what is recorded in this book. It was neither compiled for the prurient nor the prudish, the writer's sole aim being to give, to the best of his ability, a true history. Reverend William M. Cooper, Flagellation and the Flagellants, 1870. If I whet my glittering sword, and mine hand take hold on judgment, I will render vengeance to mine enemies, and will reward them that hate me. Deuteronomy, chapter 32, verse 41. The Beginning. I have always been willing to take the blame for the things I have done. Lily Langtree. Chapter 1. There are things that fix themselves in your mind. The blue smoke of multiple weapons discharging, the flash of an evil woman's smile, or the repulsive beauty of a blood-stained silhouette on a dry wooden sidewalk. How quick it soaked into the thirsty timber. An ugly discoloration of violent history, now set like paint. Wrong place, wrong time. I am guilty of at least two sins, although there are many more I may have forgotten along the way or have never acknowledged. But as I live and breathe, I am guilty of the sin of distraction and the sin of being egotistical. The result of these sins was murder. The murder of my husband. I might not have loved him had I known that I was to be his harbinger of death. I have thought this for a long time through the ache of loneliness. The emptiness within me is not in my gut, but in my heart. I swear that outside of a couple of morning aches and pains, I do not feel any different than I did back in the 70s. But the mirror tells another tale. I look aged. I look like I have lived hard through the decades. The crow's feet are webbed now, and laugh lines have become deep creases that hold the echoes of calloused work and laughter long since gone. My skin is more weathered and alcohol-wearied than it ought to be. My breasts don't sit as high on my chest. The gravity of life has pulled down on me. Inside and out, physically and emotionally. I'm a bit slower than I was. Actually, I'm a lot slower. But I swear I don't feel any different inside. When I look in the mirror and a much older woman than myself is staring back at me, I feel as if I've been hoodwinked a little by life. But for now, I feel fine. I really do, considering. I pour the one cup of coffee I boil myself at home each morning. Any more on an empty stomach gives me the jitters. I think about my journey to becoming a useless, curmudgeonly fart. That is what happens, isn't it? Can't have coffee, can't have sex, can't have a good laugh, because then you will end up piddling in your pants. Yeah, there are lots of wonderful things to look forward to in growing old. I cringe at these thoughts, stare back at the old woman in the mirror, and think, but I feel fine. I pull down a bottle and stir a shot of whiskey in the coffee with my finger to smooth out the shakes. Not the alcohol shakes, the emotional shakes. Wrong place, wrong time. I walked to the window and looked out at what I own, what we owned. Fields stretch towards a rise, and just over the crest is the property line. Even though I may sometimes wander beyond it, my land stops there, just beyond a couple of rows of crops that I've done nothing with except let them set, to gradually work their way back to their natural state. It's been very much like the way I have treated myself, excepting I didn't pour whiskey down the plants' throats. Maybe I should tell you the story of my life, but there's not much there. One mistake, wrong place at the wrong time, and James was dead. My whole life is wrapped around that incident. It not only killed him, but it also seemed to snatch the living out of me. Maybe I'll tell you the story of my death and reincarnation. After James's death, when I created my Jericho, that was pretty much it. I put up the walls and huddled inside. When you work the land for yourself, you cannot make the choice to slip away and have time to yourself. One day, you just stop being productive. I took care of the house and did field work right alongside James when he could join me. Maybe more sometimes when he was in town keeping the peace. I came to feel that the land was mine to shape, but it never was. The land shaped me. The seasons have buffeted both of us, the land and I, worn us pretty smooth like shoreline rock.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.